Well, you know, over the last few years, we definitely have sort of had a couple of false starts, you know, where we actually did a lot of really good work, and we did really, you know, create a vision in our heads about putting out an Aerosmith album and what we wanted it to be like.
Everybody back in.
We haven't put out an album with new material since just Push Play. We did Honkin' on Bobo, but that was blues covered. But we've been on the road so much in the last, say, 8 or 9 years that we didn't have that time that we could completely put aside and just do the album. You know, just think about that as opposed to always thinking about getting ready to go on the road. I think for me, I knew that we were going to have a really fun, cool record was when Jack Douglas came on board, you know, but there's always that thought of, you know, do we want to do it just because we want to go back to the 70s because it's comfortable and we have these, you know, awesome memories of back then, or is this really a creative combination that still can work? You know, we said, come on, let's make a record. And everybody in the band was 100% into it, and Jack was 100% into it. Just started that process where we start to rehearse, where riffs come up, where we recognize a riff going by and make sure to remember it, or we record it, and then we take it and we, you know, mold it into a song.
Yeah, I want to make sure that's... Yeah, sure, you've tight. Listened to it and made sure it's okay. I mean,
I'd like to try to double that with the baritone too.
Really? Yeah. It's gonna be a bitch.
I mean, it's an easier way to play it. It doesn't get the same kind of sound, you know.
Well, I'll probably just, I mean, for now, Lauren, I'll just kind of play on the you know, the root notes and try to get the rhythm.
You know, working in the conference room together at Vindaloo was where we kind of put songs together arrangement-wise and learned them instead of everybody being in the studio diddling, making noises by themselves and, you know.
So top again and listen to it and see if there are rushes everybody.
The little conference room allowed us to sit face to face and throw ideas back and forth, run through it, make sure we knew the arrangement, and it was a really valuable little space to have to kind of culminate all these ideas.
It's not etched in stone, but wow. If we take it back to old Aerosmith, and the lyrics will be exquisite. I promise. So one more time, 3, 4, count, gotcha.
I think that the biggest, most important aspect of making this record was one that was reminiscent of Poise, Rocks, Get Your Wings. By virtue of working with Jack, Jack always makes everything fun. And when you have fun doing something, it always comes out good.
Like, we would spend 6-7 hours working on licks to see if we could. It's kind of like taking antique dough and kneading it, putting in a little stuff to make it rise. And if the stuff don't work and it don't rise, well, you have an unleavened bread. And then if you put some raisin and throw some nuts in, like Joe Perry did, you got a different type of bread, and that cooks a different way. And so we were in there doing all that and just collecting our marbles and the ideas, and it was just really cool.
There's an energy there. It's kind of like building up slowly, and it's like a tsunami racing across the ocean. You know, there's a little blip like this, but it's going 700 miles an hour, and it's carrying you know, 80 megatons of energy. And, you know, sometimes the blip goes a little bit higher. It's finally built up and it's coming up to shore, and that energy is starting to rise up. As a fan of what Aerosmith is and what Aerosmith does, I think this record is more close to the bone and the skeleton of what Aerosmith is than any record we've done in a long time. This record, for some reason, I keep wanting to listen back to it. You know, there's a certain kind of like being in the room with the band feel to it, you know, especially when I put headphones on. After being in the room with the band playing it live, and then putting the headphones on, it sounds remarkably close to that.
Perfect. And, as, you know, just keep it, you know, sometimes as simple as possible, you know.
Communicate with somebody.
Boom. And then when you come in with some of those rolls, it fucking kills. Because, I mean, there's some places where you, like even stop dead, and it's like, timing is just so perfect because it's just so laid back and it just sounds like we're playing together.
Okay, let's go. Let's do it. Something fucking like.
The first song that we put together yesterday, we didn't use a click track, and it does not move.
That's great.
Inch. It's unbelievable. It's scary because it's like, you know, I put out, and you can tell, you know, we all heard them. And this is like fucking boom, boom, boom.
Nice.
It's so locked. It's unbelievable.
Well, because you're playing with me.
Well, we're playing with each other.
Playing off each other.
There's
damn right.
Like no fucking.
And when that happens, it's like, whoa, I can't get this.
We're not trying to do anything. Behind it. Every time I did a fill, I'll never yell at Kramer again. I'll never yell at Kramer again. I'll never yell at Kramer again. I'll never yell at Kramer again.
I'll never yell at Kramer again.
Hey, I'm just saying.
Hold on. The song starts like this. 3, 3, 4.
He said to me, oh, that ain't the plan.
The basic rhythm part of Street Jesus I've had in my back pocket. So I would just, you know, reintroduce it every once in a while.
You know, I think the beat of it is very old school Aerosmith, you know, it's like a Toys in the Attic kind of energy.
I had a piano, Brad was fucking around on the guitar, and I started playing this thing and Brad played a thing. And it became a very and from that very simple blues line came me humming something, no lyrics yet, but just some blues stuff that just sat with it really good.
I got to get that joke, get that book, and got more than I love, and I'm in love.
You know, it's really important to, in rock and roll, to come up with a real groovy lick and then lay something real smooth over it.
Steven heard that, he immediately heard a melody in his head, and we started messing around with that, and put the two parts together, and that was it. It was a done deal. There was the tune.
Playing games with it, huh?
Oh, yeah. First, it was Sweet Jesus, which it can't get much more bluesier than that. And then it turned into Street Jesus when I got to L.A., because when I would come to work every day down to the studio, I'd go across Fairfax, and there'd be a guy walking that looked like Jesus. So when that idea came up, it was easy to write about somebody, because I'd already seen him and met him and say, dude, what do you like? And he just smiled, and he wasn't looking for money, but he sure looked like Jesus, man.
We were like talking about Freddie King and Albert King and all these, oh great, and my phone rings. Well, Oh Yeah started off, it was a song I wrote down in the Boneyard, and it was supposed to be more of a funk kind of vibe. Steven liked it right from the start. I was like kind of on the edge about it anyway. So I said, all right, well, we talked about it. Let's try it, changing the tempo and revisiting it. So we cut it in that classic rock and roll style. And I figured, all right, well, let's let it go at that. And then when I listened back to it, when we went out to LA, it was kind of at the bottom of my list. But I thought that with the band giving it some energy, that it would maybe cut it. And I was thinking about singing it myself. You know, I wrote it as one of the songs that I would put on the record to sing. Billy said, you know, you should really give Steven a shot at that song. He really likes it. You know, I asked him if he would do it. He said, you know, because originally we were going to kind of do it as a duet. First I was going to sing it myself, then we were going to do a duet, and then I started to hear him do it, and it was like obvious that it was going to, you know, he was going to kill it. Won't you please give us some of your love? I got eyes for you, baby. Oh, yeah. I go blind for you, baby. So much energy going on around it that I said, okay, take it away, you know. And then we put the horns on it, and then the girls came in and sang on it, and it turned into this classic rock and roll song. I mean, it's very, Aerosmith has done songs like that. It's a real classic rock and roll song. Well, music is forever. When you record it, it's there forever, and we just don't know any other way to do that. And the reason it took a year was because we had a tour to do in the middle of it. If you had compressed what we did from the time we started last summer until we wrapped it up in California, if you had taken away the tour and taken away Steven's time on Idol, probably would have taken 2 or 3 months to make the record.
Well, nice. Very close. Very close. Yeah. Do we have the 200 in there?
What's that?
Do we have the 200 in there?
Yes.
Yeah.
We're going to get fat.
Again, there's a reason for everything. It gave us a chance to do the basic tracks, go out and play in front of some hysteric, fanatic fans in South America and Japan, take that energy and that feedback that they gave us back into the studio and listen to the tracks and go, wow, we gotta raise the bar on this song, raise the bar on that song. It was probably the most creative time for me that the last 6 months in LA.
Now that last chance.
It was all part of the creative process, and I think spreading out the overdub parts and the mixing parts over that period of time gave us a chance to analyze some of this stuff a little more, for better or for worse. I could see how a lot of bands would have let it slide at this point and let the energy kind of dissipate, but it's just not the way this band's made up.
A song like this, and we fucking did, man. What a moment. Well, there's two things that can happen to a band. They can either move on musically, where you don't even know who the guy was on the first record, or you have a band that is so happy about sounding the way they sound that they don't have this need to change too much. I have a need to change, but I do it with the melodies and I do it with songs. But as you hear, it's the same guy singing. I don't sing in falsetto like an opera singer. It's the same thing, whereas a guitar player can learn how to play on guitar but do an album on ukulele. And you wonder where the hell the guy went, or you love it.
Well, I really wanted to, you know, pay more attention to the songs that weren't necessarily designed to be on the radio or to be product. You know, the songs that that were close to how we originally started. So I guess that feeling was in there, yeah, about doing an old school Aerosmith record.
What would you do? Play with a capo, or would you fucking just do it right down? Capo. Well, where's your tenor?
There have been songs that we've written that we were thinking, I mean, Steven and I would look at each other and go, this is going to go down great live. It's going to be a killer. It's going to slam. It's going to be... And we would play it a few times and it would just lay there flat. And people weren't used to it, and they obviously wanted to hear something a little more familiar or whatever. And even this was even after the record came out. So for some reason, it wasn't the right time. Maybe that song would be more appropriate now. I don't know. But so I really can't second guess what the fans think. All I know is that as a fan of what Aerosmith is and what Aerosmith does, I think this record is more close to the bone and the skeleton of what Aerosmith is than any record we've done in a long time.